championship is Celtic's.
A year of change and challenge for the champions. Elation preceded elimination.
Celtic are out of the Champions League.
And a year of heart and hope for Hearts. Relegation preceded rejuvenation.
It's a spectacular opening goal in the derby.
New faces force a new focus. New belief for those who bleed the colours. But the heart will heal, because winning heals everything.
They're a league apart this season, but Premiership favourite Celtic are far from firing on all cylinders, and Hearts, of course, are looking like a team reborn at the top of the Scottish Championship. It all adds up to an intriguing little match-up here at Celtic Park tonight in the third round of the League Cup. These two looking to join Aberdeen and Hibs, Partick Thistle, Rangers, St Johnston in the quarter-finals, and we'll have last night's highlights during half-time of this one. There are also two derbies tonight, which will decide another two places in the last eight of the competition. The Dundee Derby at Tannadice, and the Lanarkshire version is Hamilton against Motherwell at New Douglas Park. We'll have news of those two woven in with our coverage of this one. Hearts at Celtic Park, live on the BBC. Now, Charlie McGrew is not playing tonight. That's why he's standing next to me. Michael Stewart is with us as well. So let's find out who is playing for Celtic tonight, firstly, and four changes from the side which drew one each with Motherwell at the weekend. Craig Gordon returns in goal. The two who came on at half-time made such a big difference. Scott Brown and Chris Commons. They are starters as well. Stefan Johansson is back in the starting lineup for Celtic. Two players moving out of the team: Zaluska, Kyle, Beaton, and Tonev. Hearts with three changes from the side, which will be Ken Beath 5-1 on Saturday. Prince Boabin is back after suspension. Sam Nicholson is back. He starts. And Dale Carrick, too. The players dropping out are Robinson, King, and Keating. So those are the two team selections, and Charlie, maybe not too surprising, and when we saw the impact that particularly Brown and Commons had off the bench on Sunday, that they'll start in this one.
Yeah, they're big players for us. I mean, you saw it when they came on in Sunday there, that Brownie drives it for the midfield, he gets on the ball, he pushes forward and he drags everybody with him, and Commons' goals can't be overlooked. He's got a great record this last season, and he started scoring again this season. So, and he showed with the penalty the composure he's got. So, two big players for us, and it's good to see them back.
And Michael, in terms of the three Hearts changes, is the return of Prince Boabin the key one, because that's such an important area alongside Gomez in the midfield?
Yeah, it will be, especially, you know, Charlie's making the point there with Scott Brown coming back in for Celtic. It's important that Hearts get their strongest team on the pitch, and I think there's no doubt that Boabin and Gomez in the middle of the park is their strongest pairing in there, and it'll be a good matchup. It'll be a good battle tonight, and I think ultimately whoever can get the foothold in that middle of the park could go on and win the game. But Nicholson as well, coming back in on the wide areas, he's a really, really talented young player, and he could cause a lot of problems for Celtic.
The Celtic fans, Charlie, would prefer that you were in the hoops rather than in the shirt and tie tonight. How's the knee?
I got an injection yesterday on it down in London, saw the specialist, and they thought the best option was to get an injection into the knee. So it's settling down well, and I'm running on Friday, and then hopefully I can push on, get back to training next hopefully 10 days. I'm trying to say earlier, but we'll see what the physios say.
Were you worried that you might have to go under the knife?
It was spoke about, but best case scenario was the injection, because it doesn't add any more time onto my recovery, it just pushes it along if anything. If I'd got the operation, it would have been an extra couple of weeks, so it was great that I didn't have to do that, and it's really gave me a lift that I can now start running and getting fitter.
Here's a goal of yours from the League Cup. Sadly, it was scored in a game you lost, because it was against St Mirren, who went on to win the League Cup that season. Has it been surprising and disappointing for you that, in among all the success you've had with Celtic, the League Cup hasn't been kind to you?
Yeah, I mean, it's been disappointing at times. We get beat off Rangers in the final after extra time, so we're unlucky that day. Very disappointing day, and we've never managed to get back to another final after that, so that's been disappointing. And after tonight, hopefully we're in the next round of the Cup, and we can push on and do well in it this year. That's really a big aim for us, to get the League Cup this year.
The last time, Michael, Celtic and Hearts met in the League Cup competition. It was 5 years ago. This is sounding a little bit like This Is Your Life, because you'll never guess who scored the only goal of the game. Well, you actually will guess.
Wasn't it Charlie?
No, it wasn't Charlie.
Yeah, I can remember the penalty. It's a fantastically struck one that just sneaked over the line. All count.
How did you hit that with your timbies on?
Chabba was a wee bit excited about it as well. That was a good result though. I think we got through to the semi-final and ended up playing on a bit of a boggy pitch at Fir Park against St Mirren, and unfortunately we never got through to the final. But I think that it was a great result because we were going through a bit of a sticky patch at that time, and to come to Celtic Park and win the game with a fantastically struck penalty was a good night.
Not the most convincing penalty I've ever seen, I have to say. The current Celtic manager, Ronnie Dyla, wouldn't fancy a repeat of that League Cup result from 5 years ago. That is for sure. It's been a tough start for him in this Celtic job. He's been talking to Al Lamont. He's convinced he's making good progress.
I think we're getting there. I think to have a consistency in the team also when you the starting 11 is important. And when we had that, I think we are progressing. But when we have switched a lot of players, then in the same time, we have been struggling like the first half now on Sundays.
Motherwell in front, and it's a brilliant finish from Sutton.
But again, when we get on more experienced player, we get the momentum back and we played a good second half. Of course, the European football has been one of the reasons why we have changed it on the team, of course. But it's also about fitness and about injuries. So it's a lot of things is behind the decisions.
What are your ultimate goals then this season? I mean, would you see the treble as being attainable for you this first season?
It's a goal. It's a huge goal. And of course, it's going to be very difficult. But as you say, we have a chance. And now we just have to go into every game and do everything we can to win it. And be good prepared and play good teams all the time. And that's now on Wednesday it starts with Hearts. And that's a big goal for us to win the treble.
Obviously Hearts, for the first time in a long time, are not in the top league. But what do you know of them, and how much have you seen of them? And they've got a new coach, obviously, too, Robbie Nielsen.
They are a young team, and they're a big club that has potential to be and been many years on the top division. And it's going to be a tough game because they have a good confidence now and they are playing good. So I'm very looking forward to it. And I've been watching them on television. We have people been to the games and watch them as well. So we know what we're going to meet, and we know it's going to be tough. But we also know how good we are when we play as we did the second half yesterday.
He seems like a really nice guy, Ronnie Dyla. What's he like to work with, Charlie? What's his style, and are you convinced that he'll prove to be the right choice?
Definitely. I mean, he's a really nice guy, really, really top coach. His training's great. I mean, everybody enjoys it. Everybody's responding well, and yeah, he's got some new ideas, and we're all responding well to it. I think he needs time, like any manager does, and he's definitely showing the right signs.
You know, I think that's very important that you get the players on side with you. Ultimately, though, you need to get some results and build up some momentum, because it can quickly turn. Players can quickly change their mind on you. But it's good to hear that you know, the guys are buying into what he's trying to do here.
Okay, let's hear from Hearts head coach Robbie Nielsen. He's been talking to Brian McLaughlin, and they're not high flying at the top of the championship by chance. He says it's all down to hard work.
If players want to get to the top, they need to work hard. You know, and I believe that, you know, if you want to stay the same, you train for an hour and a half. If you want to get better, then you need to train more. You know, and I was coming through as a player, it was very much, you know, you come in, you report at 10 o'clock and you're away for 12, you know, and you're never going to develop with that. You know, the boys now come in at, and they'll be in for half 8, 9 o'clock, and they'll leave at 3, 4, half 4 sometimes. And again, there's got to be a balance between developing them, but also the Saturdays, the important thing is about winning games.
Will you be able to relax when you go to Celtic Park on Wednesday?
Yeah, you know, going into games, I'm pretty relaxed about it. You know, we do our preparation before it. You know, we prepare right after the previous game, you know, and give the players all the information and as much as we can, so that when we get there and they're out doing their warm-up and they're ready, you know, and it's just a case of trying to motivate them before the game and giving them little last bits of pieces here and there to try and help them.
Celtic lost to Morton in the League Cup, it was last season. Do you think that they put the importance on the League Cup as Hearts do?
Yeah, I think they will. You know, I think they do, and I think they will this season. You know, we, Stevie and I went to watch the game on Sunday against Murrow, you know, and they rested six players. You know, so it shows the importance of the League Cup game to them. You know, so we know it's going to be a very difficult game, and you know we're huge underdogs going into that game, but we want to go and you know show what we can do. If a good start to the season, we want to continue.
It's Nicholson. It's a spectacular opening goal in the derby.
What have you made of Ronnie Dyla and his start at Celtic?
I've heard a lot of good things about him. I mean, I've never met him. I haven't spoken to him, but I've been speaking to people and players in there. I've heard a lot of good things about the things he's trying to do and the way he's training the players, and I look forward to meeting him. You know, I think it'll be interesting to see what his views of the game are. You know, I think he's attack-minded, and the things he's doing in training are interesting, and yeah, it'll be good. I'm looking forward to it.
We were talking about Robbie Nielsen. We were talking about Ronnie Dyla being a surprise choice. Robbie Nielsen probably falls into the same sort of category for a lot of people when he was appointed to the Hearts job, but he's been impressive, Michael.
Yeah, he has. He's a very meticulous guy. You know, he goes about his work and he's really professional. And I think that's, you know, shown with the results that Hearts have got. As you said just before the interview there, it's not by chance that they're sitting at the top of the league. You know, he was up in Aberdeen watching Livingston yesterday, obviously getting prepared for meeting them. And you know, he goes about his business in a really professional way, and you know, I'm delighted to see him doing so well. And he's got, you know, he's put together a really good team at Hearts as well. A lot of good acquisitions. But then you've got to take that forward onto the pitch and get them shaped up and get the players understanding what they're meant to be doing here. And I think you can see with the youngsters and the experienced players, it's got a good blend there and they all understand what's expected of them.
We saw the Morton goal, which knocked Celtic out of the League Cup last season. Eerily, Charlie, it's a year ago tonight. That's a suitable warning, isn't it, for Celtic?
I mean, he was playing that night.
it's a warning, though, isn't it, that if you don't get your attitude spot on, results like that happen.
I know, Morton came in and made it hard for us that night. I think that night we had something like 25 corners, so we were all over them. We just couldn't get that goal. We hit the post, I'm sure we hit the bar, so that's what happens. We've got to show tonight that we've learned our lessons from then, and we can, we're playing a strong team tonight. We can go through the next round of the Cup, because that's what we all want to get. We want to get the League Cup and get into the next round, so everybody's up for it, and hopefully we can get the result tonight, and everybody will forget about Morton last year.
OK, more from Charlie, more from Michael as well during the half-time interval. Let's get to the action now. It is Celtic against Hearts, lined up in the tunnel and bidding for a place in the quarter-finals of this League Cup competition. The commentary tonight comes from injured St Mirren striker Stephen Thompson. He's fit enough to hold a microphone and he is alongside our match commentator tonight, Liam McLeod.
Rob, thank you. Good evening. When you've been in a dark place, when you've been grappling with demons, financial or otherwise, when you found yourself staring into the abyss, there will likely be a moment in the recovery process which can tell you just how far you've come. And tonight is that moment for this Hearts team. Relegated from the top league last season, they come to Celtic Park to face a team that leathered them in their last cup meeting, but with a more experienced squad, one that has adapted to its push back to the Premiership like a duck to water so far. There's a sense that while it may not be the biggest game in Celtic season, it could be a huge night for their new manager, who you saw there. Ronnie Dyla has had anything but a comfortable start to life here. It's been a spluttering beginning so far under the Norwegian. The Champions League has gone twice. Their league form has been hit and miss. And under this cup spotlight last season, as the guys were discussing, they were found wanting. There's the director of football, former Hearts manager, former Scotland manager as well.
He was pronounced dead on arrival at the hospital. This evening, I ask you to join us in honouring both John and Gordon.
Well, it's a very different Celtic team to the one you normally see at this stage of the League Cup. All the big hitters are in. Brown and Commons return, so too the former Hearts keeper Craig Gordon. He left his first club in 2007 for Sunderland and is now the number one in this neck of the woods. Well, that's a stable looking Hearts team. It's a Hearts team that scored 23 goals in 9 competitive games so far. Look out for wide men Walker and Nicholson and big striker Osman Sow, the match winner when the Jambos won at Ibrox on the opening day of the Championship season. The man the Hearts fans love to hate is back in the Celtic squad tonight. He is Lee Griffiths. New signings Stjepovic and Tonev are also among the subs. McHattie, Robinson, McGee and Holt all have plenty top league experience. 35-year-old Willie Collins in charge tonight. He was also the referee for the 2012 final when Kilmarnock beat Celtic 1-0 across the city at Hampden. Willie Collins gets us underway. Celtic's first foray in this competition this season, up against the Hearts team, albeit in the division below, but arguably with a better squad, Stephen Thompson, than they had the last time they faced Celtic when they were in the top flight.
Yeah, definitely. I would say their purchases during the summer have been astute, especially in Gomez and Boabin in the middle of the park, who are going to be vital this evening in shutting out Celtic and protecting their back four.
We'll keep you up to date with what's happening in the other two third round matches which are taking place tonight. They kick off a little bit later. Hamilton, Motherwell and Dundee United against Dundee. The D's looking for redemption after that hammering they took against United in the league at the weekend. Callum Patterson just back from injury, played against Cowdenbeath at the weekend. 5-1 victory for Hearts to stay top of the Championship. Unbeaten in the league. The defeat this season for the Jambos came in the lower league Challenge Cup. It was a second string side they put out at Almond Vale against Livingston. This is Prince Boabin. Boabin and Gomez were such an important part of the Dundee United team that won the Scottish Cup in 2010, reunited at Tynecastle.
You can see early on, Liam, that Hearts are more than happy to let Celtic have possession of the ball in their own half. They're retreating back to a five in front of their defensive four, and they're just going to let Celtic keep possession of the ball when it's in their own half. And when Celtic start to come up the pitch, they'll tighten up and start to put in challenges.
This is Jason Denier, who's on loan from Manchester City. He's made an impressive start to his Celtic career. Scored a couple too against Dundee United and Aberdeen in the league wins right here. Stefan Johansson, it's for Stokes. Chris Turk was there. It's long from Patterson, and so got goal side of Van Dijk, but there's just a little bit too much on it.
Yeah, well, Denier follows the ball in and leaves Van Dijk one-on-one, and if the ball had been slightly better, Osman Sow was one-on-one with Van Dijk straight through and Craig Gordon. The Celtic are going to be wary of that direct pass.
Here's Callum McGregor, who's made such an impressive start to the season, finally getting his chance here. It's a big season for him before he kicked a ball as Sow is hauled down by Denier, and Willie Collins going to his pocket here.
It's very early for a booking, it's his first challenge. Jamie Walker does ever so well in the middle of the park, winning the ball off McGregor, plays a nice pass through to Sow. I would like to see probably the referee let that one go this early in the match. Yes, it's a bad challenge, but for me it's not a yellow card.
Booking for the young Belgian. Sow struggling, so it seems.
Good movement from Sow though. He's going to be pivotal to what Hearts can do this evening, playing the lone role up front. He has to secure possession at every opportunity. On that occasion, he made a run into the channel, showed his pace and his power, and he will be vital for Hearts tonight.
6'4", Osman Sow, but he can move as well, as Denier found out there.
Puts Denier on a tightrope for the rest of the match as well.
Celtic on a bit of a tightrope here as Sam Nicholson takes the free kick. Patterson's the target. Away by Johansson. Skipper Wilson, Osterk. Van Dijk more heightened distance in the clearance. Celtic can mop up Craig Gordon, who had such a wonderful Hearts career. Great to see him back in the reckoning after 2 years more of injury misery. Thomas Turk, well over.
It's ambitious, but it's the first attempt and goal. Hearts have started the match really brightly.
There's just 3 survivors in the Hearts team from the one that played Celtic the last time. That was a league defeat at Tynecastle, 2-0 back in the spring. Patterson, Wilson and Nicholson are those 3. Stokes, Izaguirre's ball, Commons is there, very, very important clearance from Eckersley. Ambrose, first real prodding of the Hearts rearguard here from Celtic. Commons to Brown, it's not far away.
Fantastic effort. Was it Stokes that hit it in the end? I think it might have been. Again, Celtic probing, looking for the opening. And it's a fine strike from the edge of the box.
Yeah, Stokes.
From Stokes, just past the post.
It's the first time Celtic have laid a glove in Hearts so far. Hearts starting the match reasonably comfortably, though.
They have done. They've started well. And what they are doing is they're not pressing the ball. They're sitting off the game and inviting Celtic into their half. You've got to be comfortable as a defence to do that. Have them sitting in front of you, but Celtic will probe and they do have the quality to find pockets and areas in between you.
So seems to have shrugged off that earlier problem. He's on the ball here up against Ambrose.
Yeah, well defended by Ambrose. I think Hearts need to be clever. They're obviously going to play a counter-attacking game. And when Celtic are committing so many men into their half, it's about picking the moments when you do decide to attack and not flooding too many men forward.
John Guidetti is the Celtic centre forward of choice this evening. Stokes playing on the left-hand side. There he is. Alexander, such an experienced campaigner, the Hearts goalkeeper. That long spell as Alan McGregor's understudy at Rangers. Here's Denier. Adam Eckersley to Guabin. Johansson. He's bobbled away from Chris Commons and Guidetti. This is McGregor. Brown. Guidetti did well to divert that towards goal. Alexander clutching on under his bar.
Yeah, it was a clever wee ball in from Scott Brown and Guidetti just trying to get his head on it, but Osterk marshalling him.
John Guidetti, like Jason Denier, on loan from Manchester City. There's Wilson. Yeah. Walker. And so, testing Ambrose again, this time he gets the beating of him, but Brown and Denier were there throwing up a green and white wall for Osmond So to get past, and he couldn't.
It was well done from So. He linked the play initially from the ball from Wilson, and when he gets it back, he wins his team a throw-in up the pitch. That's what he needs to do all night, retain possession for Hearts.
Patterson forces it forward. And a clip there on Carrick, the referee's not interested. Disappointing afternoon for the Celtic supporters here at the weekend. They could only draw with Motherwell, kept from behind to draw that game. It's Eckersley up from the back. Jamie Walker! Geoff McGregor for a corner.
Great play again from Hearts, and when Walker really gets a hold of this shot, luckily for Celtic, it deflects off for a corner, but Hearts are really putting them impetus on Celtic and forcing themselves forward in the game now. That shot was travelling, definitely going on target, and it's the first corner of the match for Hearts.
Jamie Walker to take, one of the Hearts youngsters who found himself into the first team as a result of the problems that they had over the last couple of years. Not his best corner though, So trying to make the best of it, turns it back to Walker. McGregor comes to meet him, Walker's ball, away by Van Dijk, Boabin's effort. Yeah, come off a Celtic man last, it's going to be another corner to the visitors.
You just wonder when he hits this, if the ball doesn't deflect and it lands at So's feet, if he's onside. Just there. I think he might have been onside.
He touched it. He'd been in on Gordon. Better from Walker this time. Patterson's up, So too Ambrose. Stokes away to Johansson. Can't turn it into the path of Godetti. Wabbit. There's Eckersley. Wabbit again.
Hearts are keeping possession of the ball very, very well. Looking very comfortable at passing. Look like a team that are confident.
Top of the championship. And coming forward, Patterson turned towards his own goal by Denier. And out for Hearts' third corner in about a minute.
Well, it's a vital interception for Denier, because if he doesn't touch it, So's got a tap in it. Into a net. How many times have you seen that get into its own goal? So many times. Hearts really turned the screw here.
Short corner this time is worked back to Jamie Walker. I've seen Jamie Walker score many times, it seems, from outside the box. Not on that occasion.
Yeah, I think it was the wrong choice in the end. When he gets it back, it's a difficult angle, slightly off balance. Just put it back into the area. All your men are up from the corner and circulate the ball. But promising again from Hearts.
Just the one clean sheet so far this season for Craig Gordon. It has been a problem for Celtic in the early stages of the season. It's a good play by Gomez. Boabin managed to squeeze it through to his teammate out on the right hand side, Carrick. Free kick for Stokes. To wait for Willie Collum. He wasn't ready. He's now. It's a Aguirre. Callum Patterson play as a striker for Hearts. His primary position is the one he is in tonight at right back. Denier. Goes to Brown. Johansson.
Anderson here was man of the match recently for his country. European Championship qualifier against Italy, they lost the game. He was the top man by all accounts. Ambrose forces it towards McGregor. Wilson came to meet him and missed it completely. Oh, it's dreadful defending there. And Guidetti boots the post in frustration because he knows he should have put Celtic in front there.
Absolutely. In the end, it's a very bad miss, but the only thing worse than it probably is the defending from Oztuck here. Just put your foot through it and clear it. What are you doing? And in the end, John Guidetti, you'd expect him to finish that. That is a golden opportunity.
John Guidetti missing a glorious opportunity to open his Celtic account. And so, giving Van Dijk a hard time up the other end, Denier comes across. Commons. It's for Guidetti again. Good movement from Celtic here. Clicking into gear. Too high for Commons. Stokes was there. And Patterson blocks, crucially.
John Guidetti does very well. I thought he had an opportunity to go down under the challenge, I think, from Wilson. As he enters the box, stays on his feet, hands a lovely ball up. And in the end, it's good defending from Callum Patterson.
Warnings for the Championship side in the last couple of minutes. The Scottish champions. Robin's trying to stab it towards goal. He's still in there. So's Denier. And Alexander holds on.
It was all a bit scrappy, really. The quality of the corner wasn't that great, but it managed to find the Commons in the box, who took a lovely touch. You think he's going to swivel and hit it. And in the end, it falls to Denier. He tries to toe bash it, couldn't get enough on it, and comfortable for Neil Alexander.
Izaguirre.
Needless, he wasn't going anywhere. You've got him where you want him. Silly foul.
Hearts have won the last two League Cup clashes, both of them here. The 2-0 in 2007. Double from Andreas Velička, remember him? A 1-0 win, which the guys were talking about beforehand, Michael Stewart penalty, 2009. Patterson. Osterku was bailed out by Guidetti, missing that opportunity earlier. It's poor for Neil Alexander that time.
Yeah, normally his distribution's very good. It's the slack one there.
He's a Hearts fan as a boy, Neil Alexander. Living the dream.
Let's move! Effie!
So, capitalise on poor Celtic possession. It's poor Hearts possession from Walker, McGregor. Sting Eckersley. Goal kick.
Excellent defending from Adam Eckersley. McGregor tries to take him on the outside, but Adam clearly shown he's got the pace to cope with that. It's a fine challenge.
His brother Richard, who I know you know, Stephen, is currently a teammate of Thierry Henry at the New York Red Bulls.
Can't be bad. Yeah, I played with Richard at Burnley. Really nice guy, very good right back. Can't be bad, New York Red Bulls.
And you had a spell at Burnley as well with John Guidetti, one of his other clubs on loan.
I did. He's not
a character, is he?
Well, he is.
Here he goes now. Osterk's there before him. Temporary intermission though. Guidetti still has it. Ambrose. Celtic beginning to grab this game with the scruff of the neck. This is Commons. It's good play from him to shape the angle up against Gomez.
It's good movement from Commons, finding space in the box. He's been finding it difficult to get on the ball because of Hearts have made that area so compact. But he loves to shoot, and that was his first attempt on goal of the night. Yeah, John Guidetti is not the shyest of guys. When he came into the Burnley changing room, I had my iPod on playing some indie music, and it was his first game, and he came into the changing room and put my iPod off and said, "What's this rubbish?" and put on some Dutch house music. So I swiftly told him to get that off.
That's a good few years ago as well, and he's...
He was just a lad, but he's an extremely talented player. He really is, and it was very unlike him to miss that opportunity, because one thing I would say that his main attribute and his outstanding attribute is his finishing. And he's an extremely skillful player as well, and I think over the course of the season, or over the course of his loan period, he'll be a big player for Celtic.
He's only 22, John Guidetti, important phase of his career. Tough looking challenge between Ambrose and Eckersley there.
Yeah, his brother liked a challenge like that as well, so they've obviously got similar traits.
It's the new Celtic gaffer. He's been up and down since he replaced Neil Lennon way back in June. Those two Champions League knockouts from Legia Warsaw and then Maribor won. Even such a surprising reprieve was the one that stuck in the throat the most, I would imagine. Really was a capitulation against Legia in their first attempt in the round before. Scott Brown was missing that night. He's on the ball to find Commons. Commons could be in. Cross comes Oztürk, and Celtic, they're beginning to turn it on now.
They're starting to find space, starting to find movement in between the Hearts lines, and that was excellent play again. Great pass to Commons. He's just trying to work it on his left foot, and in the end probably a touch too many, and Hearts can recover.
Just lost sight of the ball at the crucial moment, did Commons. He'll take this corner. Stokes was there. Brief shout for handball from a couple in green and white hoops. There's Guidetti. Commons, Brown, stings Neil Alexander's fingertips there. It's another Celtic corner. Hearts are having to weather a storm.
Yeah, Celtic turning it on now. Scott Brown is very good from the edge of the box. The ball sits up nicely for him. It's just straight at Neil Alexander. It's a good save in the end, but any direction on it at all, he caught it well enough, probably would have been a goal.
Missed the entire European campaign, did Scott Brown, with a hamstring injury picked up in pre-season. It's well kept in by Virgil van Dijk. To no avail in the end. Celtic delighted to see van Dijk still at the club at the closure of the summer transfer window. It looked like he was off. Johansson, McGregor, Robin. Johansson under all kinds of pressure there, that could have been more costly than it ended up being.
Celtic are committing more and more men to the attack. They're almost playing four up front at times, and they're back three or two. Van Dijk and Denayer are pushing on well into the Hearts half, and they're putting Hearts under pressure. But the problem with that is when Hearts do,
Wilson had to try and get away. Got it. It's a first goal for John Guidetti in the green and white hoops of Celtic. And it's one that puts them in front against their championship visitors. First blood Celtic.
Well, it's been coming. They've had two or three warnings in the last 5 minutes. And this time, John McGetty makes no mistake with this finish. He'll be delighted to get off his account for Celtic Football Club. Danny Wilson's got to do better with a clearing header. Out for a corner, anywhere other than where he put it. He almost heads it right into the path of John Guidetti. I don't know why he's trying to header the ball back into the danger area when you've got a header at wide of the post for a corner. It's a mistake, and it's a costly one at that.
Well, Stephen will know more than anyone else that a striker wants to get his first goal for his club as soon as possible. Appearance number three, and the Swede Gudetti is off the mark for his new club.
Yeah, it's no surprise. It's no surprise. You know, when he was on loan in Holland, I think he scored 20-odd goals. Feyenoord, was it?
And 20 in 23 appearances for Feyenoord.
Yeah, and you know, that just shows the quality that he has at a very good standard of football. And he will get opportunities playing up front for Celtic. That's one thing that you can guarantee as a striker for Celtic, and he definitely knows where the back of the net is.
That's a position. It's up for grabs. That's for sure. Stefan Stjepovic, who signed a four-year deal with Serbia international, who's on the bench tonight, hasn't really impressed thus far in the games that he has played. The Gudetti has, he's good movement, he's got a finish on him as well, as we saw there, and Celtic are quickly looking for a second to really knock the stuffing out of Artur Midlothian.
Well, this is what Ronnie Dyle has been talking about. When they go 1-0 up, to smell blood and go and get the second and third goal, they haven't been doing it, they've been allowing teams back into the match, and I'm sure that'll have been a focus of his pre-match talk, that if you do score, or when you do score, get the next goal quickly.
There's the Stokes corner. Picked away by Carrick, I think, and then turned towards goal again by Gudetti, who almost had two in just 2 minutes, but for Adam Eckersley. Here they come again. Hearts are swimming against the tide.
You wonder if they'll have two better chances.
Yeah, he could have had a hat-trick so far in this first half. Izaguirre deep, now McGregor.
It's a golden opportunity again for John Gudetti. He'll be furious with himself. You're right, he could have had a hat-trick, probably should have had a hat-trick.
Wonderful defending by Eckersley, who started his career at Manchester United. Like so many others, he's had to go far and away to rediscover himself and loans at Royal Antwerp, Bromby, Barnsley and Port Vale. Denmark for 6 years as well, with Horsens. 29 now, and he finds himself at Tynecastle, but he started this game well. Certainly doesn't look out of place in this company. Macaro Gomes. Hearts haven't found themselves behind too often this season. Wonderful win at Ibrox, right at the start of the championship campaign. 2-1 that was. There's the aforementioned Eckersley. Back to Nicholson, who we haven't seen much of so far. Beyond the quarter mark. Nicholson now. Got by Denier, so he scored a screamer against Hibs in a league victory in August. Walker keeps it in. Yeah, goal kick though.
Yeah, Hearts, after their bright spark at the start, have really struggled to get their key players on the ball. Osman So, Nicholson, who's been a real standout for Hearts, hasn't really been involved. Jamie Walker hasn't been making those dynamic runs and driving at the Celtic defence, simply because they're all in their own half, and Celtic have got them camped in. They can't get out and they can't get on the ball because of the pressure they're under.
Stokes is trying to play in Gudetti, who appreciates the effort.
I think Gudetti was looking for a wall pass, a 1-2, late back to Stokes, he can get his shot off. It's probably only the first time they've maybe played together, first or second time. You know, it'll take a while, always does as a striker, to find partnerships, to find what your other striker likes to do.
Rob was talking to Charlie Mulgrew, who injured of course can't play tonight, before the match, and talking about this competition being Celtic's Achilles heel. Going out to Hearts, Rangers in the final of course, Kilmarnock in the final, St Mirren, Stephen St Mirren in the semi-finals a couple of seasons ago, then this time last year, this day last year, to Greenock Morton, who later in the season lost 10-2 to Hamilton Academical right at the end of the championship campaign. An unlikely victory. Dougie Imrie with an extra time winner here, knocking Celtic out. An astonishing result, and the longer the season went on, The longer Celtic's unbeaten runs went, the more astonishing it became. It's a Hearts corner here. Good run by Boivin.
Yeah, that's a bit more like it from Hearts. Boivin, one of those sitting players, making a dynamic run forward. In the end, it's a good tackle from Benaya. But a chance for Hearts to bring the big men up and work on a set piece.
Walker corner, Carrick amongst others waiting. Looks like Denier. Prince Boivin trying to turn it back out to Jamie Walker. It's going to arrive there in the end via Eckersley. Celtic really should have cleared that. Plenty corners coming the way of the men in maroon.
Don't know what Denier wants to take a touch there for. That ball's rolling to him. Just clear your lines. Relieve the pressure, tries to take a touch and it's a mistake. And gives another corner kick to Hearts.
Dale Carrick, who you saw in the middle there for Hearts, scored a couple in the weekend victory. He awaits again. Here by Denier, he feels a bit better now. Conceded the corner in the first place. The 19-year-old from Brussels. A new Vincent Kompany, by all accounts. Not far off the Belgian senior squad. Let's do well to get into that. Meantime, the Hearts attack breaks down. Celtic's last League Cup triumph was in 2009. They beat Rangers after extra time. Goals from O'Dea. The Gidi penalty. It's well worked. Izaguirre. Wonderful build up from Celtic. Gomez is in the right place at the right time.
Fantastic play from Izaguirre down the left. A really neat 1-2 with Stokes. His delivery's not bad. Well defended by Hearts. It's another corner to Celtic.
Really good approach to the game by Celtic tonight. Stokes, away by Wilson. There's a little push there on Sam Nicholson that's drawn the Hearts free kick, takes the pressure off a little bit because they were under serious pressure even after the Celtic goal. Celtic keeping them hemmed in. It's calmed down just a bit in the last couple of minutes.
That's one thing Hearts can't afford to do. When they do get possession of the ball in the middle of the park or at the back, they need to try and build a wee bit more. They've just been a wee bit too back to front. Tosman's so at the minute without any real quality. And possession is key when you're up against it. You've got to try and keep the ball.
Oh, that might. Oh, it looked as though it was going to come through to Chris Commons. Wilson was there. There was no flag. Yeah. 32 and a half in. Celtic in front, thanks to that John Guidetti goal. The Swede, with his first strike, the Scottish champions. Hearts started promisingly, and they've had possession, they've knocked it about okay. So a poor clearance from Danny Wilson allowed Guidetti the shot at goal, and in truth Guidetti should have had another couple. As Izaguirre crosses, oh, and Gomez, wonderful save from Neil Alexander, from his own man.
Again, brilliant play from Izaguirre down the left, a fantastic delivery. And Neil Alexander has to make a wonderful reaction save here. Although it's pretty poor from Gomes, I have to say. Another mistake, but he's saved by his goalkeeper.
Van Dijk was in the Netherlands squad for their opening European Championship qualifier. He didn't play. They lost to the Czech Republic, and here he is in an attacking position. Mostert turns it behind for yet another corner.
Is that the Celtic centre-half?
Incredible, isn't it?
Well, it is, and he does ever so well, except his final ball. he tries to be a wee bit too fancy, a wee flick with the outside of the right foot. When he's got two or three options, just pick somebody out with a solid pass with your left foot instead of trying to flick at the ball, and it would have been another goal for Celtic.
Might still be here. Hearts have to face another Anthony Stokes corner kick after Willie Collin has sorted things out. Denier and Oztarc are being spoken to. Denier, he was booked, remember, early on. The late challenge on Osman Sow. Stokes it is. Carrick as well, good header away. Rosie Zaguirre. Again, it's a really good combination out there tonight for Celtic, is Stokes and Zaguirre. Zaguirre looks like he's in the mood tonight.
He's having a fantastic match, and you're right, it's two or three times now he's combined Anthony Stokes on the left-hand side, and it's causing Hearts real problems.
Stokes, Izaguirre again. Yeah, it drifted out of play, the cross from Izaguirre, not his best tonight. Spotted by Willie Conker, the assistant referee on this near side. Celtic attacking the east end of Celtic Park in the first half, as they tend to do in the first half of matches. The other third round ties tonight getting underway. Hamilton, Motherwell, Dundee United, Dundee. What a game that could be at Tannadice, coming just a few days after United's 4-1 thrashing of Paul Hartley's team on their own turf. To cross the road to go to Tannadice tonight against a United in form and top of the SPFL Premiership, joint top with Cali Thistle. Goals scored as United top Celtic, 5 points behind those two, but with a game in hand. It's against Partick Thistle here. Eckersley, well, looked like it might have come off Eckersley in its way through there, but Callum McGregor's been flagged offside.
Well, this time it was Denier, Celtic's other centre-half, playing in the last third. He's just gone a wee fraction too early. It would have been Guidetti again on the end of it. But it just shows you it's so hard to defend against when you've got the Celtic centre-halves breaking in like that.
Already through to the quarter-final draw, which is tonight. It's at Tannadice, the completion of that Dundee derby. And the Lanarkshire derby between Hamilton and Motherwell. Draw at Tannadice for the quarters. It'll be live on BBC Radio Scotland Sports Sound on 810 medium wave after all the ties are done tonight, including this one, which Celtic lead Aberdeen already through Partick Thistle. Apologies, Stephen, his St Mirren side losing after extra time. That Nathan Eccleston goal last night, Falkirk 1, Rangers 3. It was St Johnston and Hibernian also through to tonight's draw after their victories last night. It's Johansson. McGregor. Well, Jamie Walker's won a free kick here, and Willie Collin wants to speak to Callum McGregor.
I think it might have been a slight over-exaggeration from Jamie Walker there on the challenge. He was caught, but a wee bit theatrical in the way he went down.
He's bounced straight back up. It's poor from Hearts. Collin's almost got through. One of the men in Scottish football you don't want to be conceding possession to in that kind of scenario is Chris Commons. 3 goals this season for Commons, 32 last season. Foul by Brown and Gomez.
He's really not getting enough of the ball. He's not getting enough service as a lone striker. And when he does get service, the quality of it's poor.
About 1,200 Hearts fans have come along the M8 tonight. They would have come come here in confidence. The only defeat this season so far was when a second string side lost in that Challenge Cup tie to Livingston. Prodded forward by Nicholson for So, deniers there for Celtic. Brilliant footwork there by F.A. Ambrosi, as his critics, but that was good. Playing it right back, a position he knows very well, given he plays it for his national team, and did at the World Cup finals in Brazil, as Nigeria reached the last 16. I was talking about that Livingston victory over Hearts in the Challenge Cup. Here's the man who masterminded it, the Livy boss, John McGlynn. His team lost to Aberdeen last night. Mark Birchall, former Celtic striker, to his left.
Two of my teammates as well at the game, watching their Man City friends, Adam Drury and Ellis Plummer, watching Dyer and John Guidetti.
Yeah, on the losing side last night, Mark Birchall there, who's part of the Livingston coaching setup with John McGlynn, watching on, began his career here. It's incredible the amount of players that teams like Manchester City and Chelsea have out on loan at clubs. I was reading something yesterday about Chelsea. They've got more players out on loan than they do in their first team squad. It's incredible.
That's hilarious. I mean, the size of the squads that these clubs have, it just shows you the finance that the clubs have to be able to run a squad of that size. If other clubs round about, like Celtic, like St Mirren, can benefit from the system, then great.
Well, that stayed in play, that cross. Hearts were waiting for the flag to go up, as it did a few minutes ago. It's Carrick, and ran over the ball there.
Great strength from Scott Brown, making a recovery run. Shoulder to shoulder challenge, just showing his strength and experience.
Just, I mean, we know Celtic missed Scott Brown throughout that European campaign. It was a futile campaign for them with regards to the Champions League. How much of a difference would he have made had he not had that hamstring injury, had he played, had he been in the Celtic engine room?
I think he would have made a lot of difference. I think you can already see now that he's back, Celtic, they have a leader on the pitch, whereas I felt as though they're possibly a wee bit soft in the European qualifying games.
They're at it again, Izaguirre and Stokes, really good interchange, maybe a way forward for Ronnie Dyler. We know Stokes likes to play through the middle, but he's played very well out in that left flank with Izaguirre to support him.
100%, yeah, and if he's going to try and build a team of players playing in positions, they need to build relationships with each other, and that is one that looks very fruitful this evening. I think he's going to have to, Ronnie Dyler for me, has to start playing the same team on a more regular basis if he's going to try and find consistency. And I know he's talked about rotating his squad, but you're not going to get the consistency doing it.
Stokes takes the free kick. It's right down the throat of Neil Alexander. Hearts cannot afford to concede a second before the interval. Here's Osman So. He would love a leveller before the interval. That's not a bad ball for Nicholson. Just a little bit too close to Brown. Nicholson, had he begun his run a little bit earlier, might have found himself in there.
Well, it just shows you the danger of the counter-attack. One long ball from Neil Alexander. Osman So holding the ball up very well. That pass had been an inch, 2 inches longer. Nicholson might get his foot on it. He's one-on-one with Craig Gordon. That's the danger Celtic need to watch for. And that's why Ronnie Dyle has been talking about getting the second goal, killing teams off. And whilst it's 1-0, Hearts are very much still in this game.
That's going to complete to McGregor, but Alexander's there. Doesn't generally take a pragmatic approach to these kind of games, Ronnie Dyler, to any kind of games. We saw in Warsaw, 2-1 down Celtic, we're going into the last 10 minutes of that one, but he was still waving the players forward. 2-1 down to 10 men. 2-1 defeat in Poland would have been a wonderful result in the end, as Denier fouls So. He does like to commit players forward, and you can see even tonight, a game that they look pretty comfortable in, they have been caught up the other end of the park.
They have. I mean, he has an attacking philosophy, which is great. It's entertaining to watch. But the one problem is, at times, you are going to get caught on the counter, on the break. Celtic have had one clean sheet in their last 9 games. Compare that to last season, when they had 13 clean sheets in a row and over 20 in the league in the year. And there's a fine balance between committing too many men forward and leaving yourself exposed. And I think they've got to find that balance, this Celtic team.
About to go into the final minute of this first half. Dyla and Collins in conversation. John Collins, who led Hibernian to League Cup success in 2007. Hammered Kilmarnock in that final.
It's a golden opportunity.
Will they have a better one tonight? Osman Sow trying to keep it alive. He can't do that. And Celtic very much out of jail. Just those defensive frailties that we were talking about. Exposed once again, this time by Hearts. And Jamie Walker couldn't take advantage of it.
It's another horrendous mistake. I think it's Anthony Stokes tries to play it back. And he's so unlucky as Jamie Walker. I personally would have gone low into the bottom corner. Goalkeeper's left hand side, he's tried to lift it over Craig Gordon and he's just lifted it a fraction too high and it's come off the bar. That's going to be their best chance tonight probably, and it just goes to show again what we were talking about. You're right, Liam, that Celtic aren't killing teams off and they're giving teams the opportunity through slackness to get back into the match.
Craig Gordon was beaten there, the crossbar came to his rescue. Here comes Prince Boabin, Celtic looking a bit jittery at the end of this first half all of a sudden. It is dragged well past by Boabin.
They seem to have problems clearing the line, Celtic. Boabin gets a clear opportunity to hit this. Just drags it, drags it. I think he sees a defender sliding in and drags his shot. He's so unlucky, Jamie Walker there.
He'll be thinking about that all night tonight. Definitely. As the half-time whistle goes. At Celtic Park, Hearts have looked pretty comfortable in possession, but Celtic have turned the screw just in that middle part, that middle section of the first half. John Guidetti could have had a first half hat-trick tonight. He has just one, but it is the one goal that separates the two, the Swedes first for the club. And at half-time in the Scottish League Cup third round tie in the East End of Glasgow, it is Celtic 1, Heart of Midlothian 0.
Well, what an amazing end to that first half here at Celtic Park. Celtic have dominated, one ahead, could have been further in front, clearly, by the chances they created. And what an opportunity for Jamie Walker, almost on the half-time whistle, to make the scoreline 1-1. Charlie McGrew and Michael Stewart watching it with me. Well, what a sucker punch that could have been, Charlie, for Celtic.
Yeah, it would have been a bad time to lose a goal. Disappointing that he got in there in the first place, but thankfully came off the bar and... we go in 1-0 up.
He'd so much time, Michael, didn't he? Maybe he'd too much time to think about it. How much will Hearts regret, do you think, missing that chance?
Well, we'll soon find out when the end of the game comes whether, you know, that's a regrettable miss there. I think when you come to somewhere like Celtic Park and you get a gilt-edge opportunity like that, you've really got to be putting them in the back of the net. And, you know, somebody like Jamie Walker, a fantastic technique, he'll be disappointed going in there knowing that you know, he really should have found the back of the net. You know, as Charlie said, it was a very slack play from Celtic to allow him in there. And yeah, potentially maybe had a wee bit too much time and thought about it too much. And maybe if it just broke him and it was one touch to finish it, he might have hit the back of the net. But yeah, those chances are few and far between at Celtic Park, and he really needs to put it in the back of the net.
So it is 1-0 Celtic against Hearts at half-time here. Three League Cup third-round ties are going on tonight. The other two kicking off half an hour after this one. So it's early days at Tannadice in the Dundee Derby. Dundee against Dundee United. And Jim Spence is there. Jim, what's happening?
19 minutes gone here, Rob. It's 0-0, but Dundee have just missed a penalty. It was John Rankin who downed Paul McGowan in the box. Greg Stewart stepped up. He slammed it right down the throat of Chiersnyak, who dived slightly to his right, and he turned it away for a corner kick. It's been a barnstorming start. Dundee went close in 5 minutes. Martin Boyle whipping a shot from the right-hand side. It was turned away by Chiersnyak for a corner. From that corner, Tankulic fired in a shot. It was blocked at the feet of Chiersnyak. And then Chiefchi from the left-hand side with the outside of his right boot swinging a ball across, and the keeper, Kyle Leather, looking lively to touch it away from under the bar. So Dundee just missing the penalty, but it's been a barnstorming start, and it's all Dundee at the moment. But 0-0 here at Tannadice between United and Dundee in front of a full house. Great game.
So there's a Dundee derby and there's a Lanarkshire derby tonight as well at New Douglas Park. Hamilton against Motherwell. Richard Wilson is there. Richard, what's happening early on?
Well, Rob, we're into the 22nd minute here, and it's 0-0, and there's not really been a chance worthy of the name so far. Both sides have been fairly cagey. Louis Longridge for Hamilton had a shot blocked inside the penalty area. Lionel Ainsworth for Motherwell sent a ball across the face of the goal that nobody could get on the end of. But otherwise, we've not really seen much open play at all. The most interesting aspect of the game so far has been the two sets of fans goading each other. There's been a flare let off in the Motherwell end. So the atmosphere is pretty heated, but it's fair to say the game itself hasn't sparked yet.
The draw for the quarterfinals is later on tonight, once that Dundee derby is finished at Tannadice. Five teams are already through. Let's review last night's action. And talking us through it, Kerdy Ninsan and Al Lamont.
On this evidence, Aberdeen clearly don't plan on relinquishing the League Cup easily. A strong Don side were ahead as early as the 8th minute. Ash Taylor putting them in front. Scott Brown in the home goal was called into action on more than one occasion though. Gary Glenn testing the keeper here. But the new twin-pronged attack of David Goodwillie and Adam Rooney again proved lethal for Aberdeen. Goodwillie's expert back heel, Rooney's clinical execution. But then a low point for the home side, Ryan Jack, stretchered off after what looked a fairly innocuous challenge. With a quarter of an hour to go, Rooney claimed his second and Aberdeen's third. This drilled effort finding Darren Jameson's bottom corner. And just as he did against Daugavpils Riga earlier in the season, the Dons' number 9 claimed his hat-trick. Johnny Hayes with the rifled cross, and Rooney sneaked in to prod home. A solid victory for Derek McInnes's men, and another match ball bagged by Rooney.
In August, Rangers left the Falkirk Stadium with a 2-0 win, but they fell behind in this cup clash after only 5 minutes. Steve Simonson spilled, Blair Alston shot, and Rory Loy reacted well. Just 2 minutes later, Rangers were level. Stevie Smith's cross expertly turned past Jamie McDonald, but into his own net by Owen Tudor-Jones. Then a strong penalty claim turned down for the home side. Joe Shaughnessy going to ground in the box after a challenge from Ian Black. Into the second half, and Rangers took the lead through Dean Shields. A clever through ball by Smith, and a calm finish from Shields. Another of Stevie Smith's dangerous crosses was met by John Daly, forcing a great save from McDonald. Then the moment that infuriated Peter Houston, he and Rory Loy were convinced Bilal Mosny blocked a shot on target with his hand. It does seem to hit his arm, but could he do much about it? With no award given, Rangers wrapped up the match in style. David Templeton's layoff, and what about this from Ian Black? So Alan McCoy's men safely through to the quarterfinals.
Ross County and Hibs have both struggled for form this season, but it was the Championship side who took the lead. Liam Craig's fine delivery found Dominique Malonga unmarked in the box. Alan Stubbs' side doubled their lead in 36 minutes with a very similar goal to their first. A lovely counter-attack move saw Dylan McGeoch find Malonga in the centre of the park. He moved it out to the overlapping Lewis Stevenson. And having evaded the challenge of Jackson Irvin, Stevenson delivered a pinpoint cross for that man Malonga again. A rare moment of cheer for the travelling Hibs fans. The visitors had to see out the match with 10 men though. Dylan McGeoch dismissed for a poor challenge on county winger Joe Cardo. Referee Stephen Finney dishing out a straight red to the on-loan Celtic midfielder.
Kilmarnock and St Johnstone fought out a close encounter at Rugby Park. It wasn't to be a great night for Kilmarnock talisman Alexei Eremenko on his first start of the season. Referee Stephen McLean booking the Finnish international for diving under Murray Davidson's challenge. No complaints from the midfielder. Tommy Wright's side took the lead in the 54th minute. Good work down the right-hand side between Dave Mackay and Lee Croft, who was in no rush to hurry his delivery, and his patience would reap a nice reward. It's not the prettiest build-up you'll ever see, but it was well worth the wait, and the finish came from Brian Graham. The on-loan Dundee United forward scoring his third goal in four games for the Perth club. With 20 minutes to go, Eremenko was in given his marching orders. His miscontrol allowed O'Halloran to steal possession. The tiring Eremenko pulled him back, and a second yellow card from the referee was inevitable, as was the visitors' victory, their fifth and eighth undefeated visits to Rugby Park.
Partick Thistle progressed to the quarter-finals, defeating St Mirren in extra time. A bit of revenge for their league defeat to Tommy Craig's men last Friday. In a match with very few chances, a Nathan Eccleston strike was enough to send the hosts through. Good work from Stevie Lawless set up Christy Elliott at the edge of the box. When his shot was saved, the rebound fell to substitute Eccleston, who gave Partick only their second home win over St Mirren in 33 years.
Right, so that's a scene how five teams so far have made it through to the quarterfinals. Aberdeen, Rangers, St Johnstone, Partick Thistle and Hibs are through. We've heard from Jim that Greg Stewart's penalty saved in the Dundee Derby, but still goalless at Tannadice, goalless as well at New Douglas Park between Hamilton and Motherwell. And 1-0 Celtic against Hearts here, Premiership against Championship. And for much of that half, it looked that way, the difference between the two teams. But then right on half-time, it could all have been so different. But John Guidetti, Charlie, will be delighted at getting his first goal for the club.
Yeah, it's a great finish. He's took it well. It's came to him quite quick. And albeit it wasn't the greatest clearance for Danny Wilson, but it's great. If you look at it here, it goes wide. Emilio gets on it. And it's a great delivery in the box. I mean, it's right in between the goalkeeper and the defenders. And John Guidetti takes it well.
Charlie McGrew-esque, the cross.
Oh, wasn't that good, was it? what about Danny Wilson, though? He's played a big part in this, hasn't he?
Yeah, I mean, as a centre-half there, you've really got to try and make sure you get that over the crossbar and out for a corner, or you're putting it back to where the cross has come from. You can't be, you know, putting the ball into an area like that, because it's dangerous. And as Charlie said, it came to Guidetti quite quickly, and he's got enough on it in off the inside of the post. He'll be delighted to get off the mark in a Celtic jersey there.
It wasn't a surprise that the goal came around midway through the first half, Charlie, because Celtic were all over Hearts. They were cutting through them with great ease, creating lots of chances. And it seems as if John Guidetti's style will fit well into what Celtic want to do in the attacking positions. He seems to work.
Yeah, definitely. He's working hard for the team, and any striker that the manager plays, obviously that's a big part of it. But that's, you see him there, gets to the edge of the box.
I think that Guidetti, what he brings to the Celtic team is he's a bit of a physical presence. You see here, muscling in against the defenders there. He should score there, to be honest. Getting on the other side of Oster.
It's clever play there, the way he gets past him.
It is. But he's a bit different to the rest of the strikers. And his movement in this game so far has been quite impressive as well. I think that was Scott Brown there with a fantastic strike, getting in off the, you know, from the middle of the park that we were talking about before the game. Scott drives the team forward, and you know, there are a number of chances here from Celtic. This was McGregor, and that was a really good clearance there from Eccleston off the goal line.
Came on quick again there, never had much time to think about it, and it's react. He's reacted well, but it's good clearance in the line.
But you know, Guidetti brings something different to Celtic in that attack. You saw before he came in, Griffiths, Stokes, they're all very similar, all very slight strikers. A great save there from Alexander. But Guidetti will be a good signing for Celtic.
What struck me, Charlie, is that Celtic had the right attitude right from the off tonight.
Yeah, that's been an important thing. These games early on in the cup, it's a lot of times about attitude and about being up for it and showing that you want to get in the next round. These teams come here and they've got nothing to lose. The likes of Hearts come up for the championship and nobody expects anything, so it's difficult. So as long as we show the right attitude the way we did in the first half, then hopefully we can go through.
There was a get out of jail card available for Hearts right at the end of that first half. Michael and Jamie Stewart, Jamie Walker even, failed to take this chance.
Yeah, I mean, as I said earlier, that, you know, it was a great opportunity for them. It's a bit of slack play, to be honest, from Celtic, allowing him in. Good quick play from Walker as well. You know, he read it here. You can see, you know, he's starting to move quicker than the rest of the Celtic defence. He gets onto just maybe a bit too much time as he runs onto that there. But, you know, he's got to be scoring that there. That's opportunities like that, a few opportunities Celtic. And to be honest, the first 20 minutes or so, I think Robbie Nielsen would have been quite happy with Hearts. They were set up quite solid. They weren't giving much away. But after that 20 minutes, Celtic started to, you know, gain a foothold in the game. And we saw, you know, a lot of opportunities that came after that. But for that first 20 minutes, Hearts were quite comfortable. They were solid in their shape. And Robbie will be telling Hearts, you know, there's only one goal in it. This game's all to play for.
I'm not sure off the bar, just a reminder to Celtic, they need another goal or two, Charlie, to make this safe.
Aye, as Michael said there, they're solid at the back and the catchers a wee bit on the break, so we need that other goal to make it a bit more comfortable. Two would be great, but we definitely need another goal here, so hopefully we can get one nice and early.
OK, teams are out, ready to go. Back to Stephen, back to Liam.
The 20th League Cup meeting between Celtic and Hearts. Celtic have won 13. Hearts have won 7. It's 3 wins in the last 4 League Cup meetings for the Jambos, who get the second half underway here. 1-0 down against a team that have won the last 10 games against them, all told. And here comes Stokes, who fancies it.
Ambitious, 30, 40 yards out. Why not have a go? He just leans back a bit and it's harmlessly over the bar.
Looking for the second. I do feel a second Celtic goal would end it as a contest.
Yeah, I think that'll have been talked about at half time and even talked about before the game, as I've mentioned before, is getting that second goal, killing teams off, not allowing teams back into game, which they very nearly did at the end of the first half.
Commons to Guidetti. Wilson stabbing it back to Alexander. A prime example of Celtic running into troubles in a game that they seemed comfortable in was the recent league game against Aberdeen here. Got themselves into a 2-0 lead right at the start of the second half. They were in cruise control. And then on the hour mark, Aberdeen pulled one back and the Dons could have ended up with a point in that game. It was aimed for McGregor, played by Eckersley.
Needless foul again from Commons.
No replays in the League Cup, unlike the Scottish Cup. It is decided on the night. Extra time and penalties if necessary. Celtic were taken to extra time by Morton last year before going out. It was a competition that, although he won it as a player, it was a competition that Neil Lennon just couldn't crack as Celtic manager. Cracked everything else, of course. Johansson conceding the free kick. Barge and Walker, who so very nearly equalised right on half-time. Well, there's Effie Ambrose at his worst.
It's just another example of Celtic being slack. You know, it's a very simple ball. He could have taken a touch. If he wants to put it out for a throw-in, he can. And in the end, he slashes at a clearance and puts his team under pressure now for a Hearts corner.
Taken short to Nicholson. Back to Walker. Plenty waiting in Maroon. It's off the head of Johansson. It's another corner kick. So Robbie Nielsen eyeing up the Celtic penalty area. Craig Gordon, one of his old Hearts teammates. Sam Nicholson to take this corner, right in front of the travelling Hearts fans. A little bit too high for Wilson. Eckersley back in, away by Van Dijk. We saw just at half-time that change being made by Celtic. The man who came on, Owen O'Connell's headed it clear, and his header might come through to Godetti. Johansson was there too, but for Neil Alexander.
Yeah, it's good play for Neil Alexander, reading the danger. He's an experienced player, playing as a sweeper almost there, coming out and clearing the danger.
Owen O'Connell there, who scored an own goal that saw Celtic lose to Inverness Cali Thistle in the league. Which made about their up and down form in the league. Celtic, that's still their only loss at that game in hand against Plantic Thistle to come. Stephen Sintmarin in the lunchtime kickoff on Saturday. Here's Van Dijk, very advanced. Oh, Eckersley, you get a touch, he did.
Eckersley's got absolutely no idea that McGregor's behind him there. And in the end, he's lucky. He tries to flick it out for a corner, and could very easily have gone wrong for him.
Celtic 14 times winners of the Scottish League Cup. Chris Commons corner. It's Patterson who leapt highest. Johansson will have to be careful. We'll just squeeze back to Craig Gordon.
You just feel one of these times Celtic are going to do something that's going to be their own downfall. A slack pass, a slack back pass like that. You just feel there's another opportunity in this game for Hearts.
Wilson under pressure from Godetti. Good start to the second half, you have to say. It's from one end to the other. Johansson, Van Dijk, and Stokes. A little tug there in Anthony Stokes. Corner only.
Yeah, the first one is Callum Patterson as a wee tug it. Stokes his shot just as he checks back inside. Looks as though he's going to hit it. If he'd gone down then, just there, he definitely pulls him, but the second one's no.
Stokes takes. Difficult one for Carrick at the near post. Normally does his work up the other end of the park, Dale Carrick. Goal scorer Guidetti waiting. He's surrounded. It's the big Swede. Stokes corner beats everyone, including O'Connell at the back post, who is the cousin of Irish rugby legend Paul O'Connell, is Owen. The own goal against Cali Fiscal was very unlucky. I think it mattered who was in that position. Very difficult ball. I think it's from Marley Watkins, from memory, the Cali Thistle winger, into a very awkward channel. That was before the Maribor game here. Ronnie Dyla made just the 10 changes for that game. Something he's been keen to do. Celtic career very much in its infancy, of course, Ronnie Dyla, but he does like to chop and change things. No messing tonight. He's gone with the top team that's available for him. It was that interchange we saw in the first half between Izaguirre and Stokes. Played by Carrick.
That's the sort of instance I'm talking about there when the ball comes up to So. I think that hits off his shin, but you just have to secure that ball, especially here at Parkhead.
Yeah, difficult times at the moment for Hearts. They're under a lot of pressure. 8 minutes into the second half, that's a foul.
Yeah, a missed time challenge there from Johansson. He knows what he's doing. You wonder how long Hearts will leave it in the match before they maybe introduce another striker, or maybe it's 70 minutes, or when they start to push more men forward, change their press from a mid-press to a high press.
Here they come with Osman Sow. Oh, he's given a penalty. It's a penalty to Hearts. Sow goes down under the challenge of Van Dijk.
Why Van Dijk hangs a leg out here, I will never know. He has no need to. Absolutely no need to whatsoever.
There's not much in that. Willie Collum sees enough.
He clips the back of his heel. He really does, and he doesn't need to. Just jockey him, he's not going anywhere, and for me, he has a wee dig at the back of So's heel, he feels it, and he's down.
Well, he's going to take it himself. Osman Sow. The Hearts fans wouldn't have known much about him before he signed in the summer. He scored a winner at Ibrox in August. What can he do here? Oh, he skies it high! Huge chance for Hearts, goes a begging.
And I thought his run-up was a wee bit casual. He looked very relaxed, but when he gets to the ball, he just leans right back. He's trying to get down the middle with a wee clip, I think, and gets it horribly wrong. It's not just going over the bar, it's going over the bar by a couple of metres.
The look of horror on Osman Sow's face said it all. They hit the bar at the end of the first half from Jamie Walker. They miss a penalty. What other chances do they want or need? They still trail.
As Mikey Short said at half-time, when you come to a place like Parkhead and you get opportunities like Jamie Walker had and like a penalty kick, you really have to take them.
Well, whereas his countryman up the other end showed prowess to put Celtic in front, Osman Sow is another Swede, misses a glorious opportunity as Gaudette goes down, and it's another penalty, and Osturk's in trouble too. Yellow for the Turk, and we have had two penalties in the space of the same number of minutes.
Well, it looks like a shoulder challenge. I need to see the replay. It looks like a shoulder challenge. Yeah, but he's into the back of John Gaudette, and he's far too forceful. The ball's running away from John Gaudette. He's not going to be able to get it. He might not get a shot and goal. You're ahead of him by half a yard. Do not bang into the back of his back with your forearm. And he's no excuses.
Chris Commons, who scored from the spot against Motherwell at the weekend to salvage a draw, has the chance to ease Celtic towards the draw for the League Cup quarter-finals. 32 goals last season, 3 this season, make that 4! Celtic double up! Just a couple of minutes after Hearts missed a chance to level this tie, Celtic creep towards the last 8. It's 2-0 to the champions.
We talk about defining moments in games. The last 3 minutes, Hearts miss a penalty and Celtic score one. And now there is no way back for me for Hearts now. I wouldn't be surprised to see Celtic go on and win this game comfortably now. It's a good penalty, sends Neil Alexander the wrong way. Gets the power on the ball. Even if he goes the right way, the power probably still takes it in at the goal.
Seldom misses from the spot, Chris Commons. He's almost hitting the 70 mark in his Celtic career. Chris Commons.
It's a phenomenal start, you consider he's mostly used as a midfielder, you know.
His debut came in this competition, it was against Aberdeen in the semi-final stage. And he scored as well, just about his first touch. Just about. Here's Izaguirre, waltzing. He's in a bad ball in either. Troubled Alexander. Hearts are on the rack. It's of their own doing. Yes, Celtic had the lion's share of the possession and the chances in the first half, but Hearts have missed two gilt-edged opportunities. Walker and So guilty. Chris Commons doing the sentencing, Stephen.
Yeah, well, Hearts will probably need to make a change shortly, I would say. Now they're going to have to come into the game. They might need to bring on another striker, change the formation perhaps, maybe go to a 4-4-2. Certainly press higher up the pitch.
The draw, remember, for the quarter-finals being made tonight at Tannadice. You'll get that on BBC Radio Scotland England on medium wave on Sports Sound after the other two ties tonight are done. And of course, later on, 7:45 kickoffs, this one starting half an hour early. Time score from New Douglas Park. It is Hamilton Academical 0, Motherwell 0. Last we heard, goalless in the Dundee Derby as well. That's heading towards half time 2. 2-0 to the Premiership champion Celtic here. Here's Ambrose. Played all of Nigeria's games at the World Cup finals. Well, four of them. Eventually going out to the French in the last 16. Here's Brown. He's a Aguirre. Between Carrick and Patterson, but they're okay. Booted clear by Patterson. Well, Craig Levein and Jack Ross there watching on. It's a long way back for their team. Stokes. Oh, Eckersley has turned it into his own net, and that will surely set the seal on Celtic's passage through to the quarters.
Yeah, well, that's game over. You know what he's trying to do? He's trying to just chest it back to his goalkeeper, but he gets far, far, far too much on it. He's into the bottom corner like a bullet, leaving Neil Alexander no chance. This John Guidetti trying to claim the goal here. It's a fantastic ball in. You see what he's trying, but I don't know, maybe just put it by for a corner. That is the game most definitely finished.
Yeah, a horrible moment for Adam Eckersley. You could see what he was trying to do. He was trying to play it back to Alexander, but the pace of the ball as it came in didn't really make that viable.
It didn't. You've got to feel sorry for him, but it's a bad mistake in the end.
Here's Stokes. His ball in it was. So he'll take a big share of credit for that one.
Oh yeah, I'll be claiming an assist.
Adam Eckersley had a very good first half. As we can confirm, half-time at Tannadice, the Dundee Derby tonight is also goalless. Clubs looking to join Aberdeen, Partick Thistle, Rangers, St Johnstone and Hibernian in the quarter-final. Celtic are basically there, unless a monumental comeback is on the cards for Hearts, but it just doesn't look that way What a huge couple of minutes it was. So missing the penalty. It was a very poor penalty from So. I'm going to make a change, Hart, shortly. Carrick's going to be replaced by Jason Hopeby here. And then up the other end of the park went Celtic. They win themselves a penalty as well. Converted by Commons. Another one in off Eckersley. Suddenly Hearts find themselves 3-0 down. Offside flag there as the change is made. Jason Holt replacing Carrick. We had a good first half, Carrick. He was always an option. He was back helping in defence as well. And it's a proper midfield player who's on in Jason Holt. Celtic change two. John Guidetti, who got Celtic's first tonight. His opening goal for the club, and I think the Celtic supporters like the cut of his jib. Guidetti, he will be replaced by Stefan Stjepovic.
He's in a good match as Sean Guidetti. Scored his goal, was involved in a lot of Celtic's forward play. His movement was good, he worked hard. Only thing that will be disappointing from his point of view is he feels as though he should have got more goals, but it's a great start for him.
Should have had three anyway in the first half, Guidetti, but he's off the mark. Stjepovic is yet to get off the mark. He's a permanent signing, arriving from Sporting Gijón in Spain. Eventually, it was a transfer deadline day move that at one point didn't look as though it was going to happen. The Guidetti one, of course, ended up being after the deadline, on loan from Man City. But Stjepovic, who's a Serbia internationalist, did arrive on deadline day, just as it looked as though he was going to Getafe, staying in Spain. Still looking to do his bit to get into the good boots of the Celtic supporters. A goal would help. Scott Brown on the ball now as it comes to Ambrose. Johansson. A lovely ball from Johansson. Not great take though by McGregor. Right idea.
Yeah, really good run from McGregor, spotted well from Johansson. A lovely clip over the defence and just his first touch at Leighton down in the end.
Owen O'Connell there, half-time sub to Van Dijk. What's a position of comfort now for Celtic, that's for sure, as we move into the final quarter, but could so easily have been different.
Yeah, it really could. I mean, the game completely changed with that penalty miss, and then Celtic scoring their penalty, and Celtic now looking extremely comfortable, popping the ball about under no pressure, and really starting to probably enjoy the match.
Made a good start to their Europa League campaign, Celtic, last week. The second tier competition in Europe. They'd rather be in the Champions League, but a draw last week in Austria against Salzburg is a good basis for moving forward in that competition. They welcome Dinamo Zagreb of Croatia here very soon, followed by FC Astra of Romania. Ronny Deila arriving from Strømsgodset in Norway in the summer. He would love a run in the Europa League, and indeed in this competition, because this competition offers him the first chance of silverware.
It's a competition they've not won in 5 years, and I think that he'll be desperate to get his first bit of silverware as Celtic manager.
Well, if he wins a treble this season, it would be breaking the mould stuff, wouldn't it?
Yeah, well, it's not happened in a while, and well, I think we're maybe getting a wee bit ahead of ourselves.
Being his first season as well, but yeah, long, long way to go, and there'll be other clubs who have a lot to say about that. As Izaguirre floats it in, goes for the corner.
He's had a fantastic match, Izaguirre. He really has been a constant threat down the left hand side.
Took the quick corner. Celtic nearly almost got another one there with the back heel from Walker. Gomez mops up. Shift for Osman So up front for Hearts now.
He's done well, you know, it wasn't a fantastic ball from Danny Wilson. It was put into an area and Osman Sow chases it down and wins his team a throw-in 70 yards up the pitch.
Spell at Crystal Palace, Osman Sow.
He really has been isolated tonight though. He's not had a lot of service, he's not had a lot of support runs. It's been a difficult night for him.
It's Boivin who spent last season at Partick Thistle. Zagiri thought about the challenge just for a split second.
He was lucky to get back because he was just caught the wrong side. It was a lovely 1-2. And he was lucky to get back in, and there's a miscontrol really.
Back to his best just in time for the international doubleheader, which is coming up very soon against Georgia, across Glasgow at Ibrox, and then the trip, the crucial, crucial trip to Poland to take them on in Warsaw.
When the ball was played, but he's maybe just drifted the wrong side of Eckersley there.
Stephen, you've been on kind of both sides of this situation. When
I've been on the end of a good few doings from Celtic.
I was going to say, you've been on both sides of the situation.
Oh, yes.
You've been at Rangers when they've dominated teams, having been comfortable. You've also been in situations as the flag goes up on the far side for offside against Stokes this time. You've been on the receiving end against Celtic and Rangers, but you've also been the Rangers team when you've given teams doings. It's a very difficult situation this for Hearts with 20 minutes still to play.
Yeah,
that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, well, very diplomatically put. But no, I mean, I think at this point in time, if you're a Hearts player, you're 3-0 down, you're probably just looking for the final whistle. When you come to Parkhead, when you go 1-0 down, you always feel as though there might be an opportunity to get back into the match. But certainly historically, when I've been playing here, when you lose the second goal, it's very much game over, and then you're just trying to damage limitation after that. Do you go chasing the game, trying to get back into it, take a heavy one, you might lose 4-5-0, or do you just try and shut up shop at 2-0? It's very difficult.
They play Livingston at the weekend, do Hearts. That match at Tynecastle on the 28th. Celtic against St Mirren. Lunchtime kickoff on Saturday. Both national finals back at the National Stadium this season after its Commonwealth Games involvement. And what about that for a back heel from Anthony Stokes? Wilson clears.
A really, really good passage of play from Celtic there. First touch passing, resulting in a lovely back heel from Stokes. Just the quality of ball into the box better. It might have been a fourth goal. That's delightful from Stokes. Again, linking up with Zagiri. We have both had a really strong partnership tonight.
Callum McGregor has been taken off. Alexander Tonev, on loan from Aston Villa, is the man who comes on. 24-year-old Bulgaria international, 10 times capped. Started 8 games for Villa last season. It's an immediate touch. Scored 3 times for his country as well, all in the one game against Malta in a World Cup qualifier. It was last year. There's the Scotland manager. Real stuff began for him in Dortmund a couple of weeks ago. Ended up being unlucky to lose the game. I mentioned the Georgia and Poland matches, which will be played just in a couple of weeks' time. The Georgia match at Ibrox away in Warsaw against Poland. But that's when the real stuff begins. That is when the pressure really starts, because that's when they're expected to pick up points. As Hearts come forward just now, brief 40 forward for them.
They just can't get a touch of the ball. Celtic are circulating the ball ever so well, keeping possession very comfortably, and Hearts just cannot get a grip on the game at all.
It was a great run forward by Alexander Tonev there, but he wasn't spotted by Ambrose. Potmans has been spotted. Kicked it in as well. Tonev.
It's a nice first touch from Tonev, bringing it from inside onto his left foot. Gets a shot on target, but it's never going to beat Neil Alexander from that distance.
The Cups were a problem for Celtic last season. They lost, as we mentioned earlier, a couple of times to Greenock Morton here at this stage exactly a year ago. And they lost to Aberdeen. They went on to win this trophy, of course, at this stadium last season. They lost to the Dons in the Scottish Cup. They were trying to right some wrongs this season. Aberdeen looked in the mood to defend this trophy last night. Adam Rooney with a hat-trick and a 4-0 win over Livingston as Stevie Crawford passes on some wisdom to Hart substitutes. He'll be on in a second. El Hassanoui is one of them. The other is Keatings.
Last throw of the dice for Hearts. I'm going to stick two strikers on and really go for it, but unfortunately I think there's too little too late.
Well, without a doubt, 15 minutes left to go. Only last cup meeting was, of course, a 7-0 victory for Celtic at Tynecastle. It was a game in which Neil Lennon was talking about football utopia after a mesmeric at times performance by Celtic at Tynecastle that day. It was the Moroccan El Hassanoui waiting to come on with James Keatings, former Hamilton player. Here's So, who will be one of those who will come off in a moment or two, and he's released Walker. Here's Walker again. Well, the ball was cleanly taken, says Willie Collum. I'm only surprised Jimmy Walker didn't release the shot.
Yeah, you're 100% right. He should have hit it a second earlier. He takes the extra touch and Van Dijk doesn't need a second opportunity to tackle him. It's a good tackle in the edge of the box.
Here's Blavin. Walker. It's a really good ball in by Jamie Walker. He asked the question of Owen O'Connell.
Jamie Walker does well, puts the ball into a good area. And in the end, it's well defended.
Hearts corner. Changes will come after this. Jamie Walker to take. It's easy to deal with. Stokes, Eckersley, who put through his own net for Celtic's third tonight. Hearts would have loved a cup run this season. They might still get one in the Scottish Cup. Of course, they would have liked a run in the cup competitions, but they've got bigger fish to fry, don't they, this season?
Yeah, I agree. I think Bobby Nielsen, the management team's focus will be on the league. They've been excellent in the league, unbeaten, and I think it's all about getting them back up to the Premier League. Osman Sogan off. He's not at his best tonight. Poor penalty there, and really, he was isolated tonight. Didn't get a lot of help from his teammates, and his service he did get wasn't the best.
The face with shades of Chris Iwolumo, that miss for Scotland against Norway. Just that sheer look of horror on So's face. It was 1-0 at the time. He ballooned it over the bar.
Yeah, it could have been very different.
That's James Keatings. Under-19s a few years ago. He was part of the Hamilton Aki squad that stunned Hibernian in the playoff, Premiership playoff at the end of last season, having finished second in the Championship behind the champions Dundee. But for that 4-1 defeat the weekend, Dundee have adapted very well, Hamilton have adapted well too, and Keatings is on the part now for his new club.
Yeah, it looks as though they're going to leave two up now. Hearts go with a 4-4-2, and it is a last throw of the dice. Try and get back into the match. If they were to get a goal, it would make for an interesting last 10 minutes, but Celtic don't really look under any pressure.
Here's Stokes. Zagiri. Big ball back! Offside flag is going to rule that effort out. Tonev.
Again, it's Izaguirre and Stokes down the left-hand side. They've been brilliant tonight. And you just wonder, if he doesn't touch it, is it going in anyway? It's a great cutback. The connection's there. And just, if he doesn't make connection, I think it's going in the bottom corner. We'll see here.
Yeah, difficult to tell from that angle. The previous one anyway.
Well, he's definitely offside when he does touch it.
Another new boy waiting for his first goal for the club. Stjepovic is another. Guidetti got his earlier. Tonev. About to go into the final 10. Tonev. Again, for comments. Celtic swaying in their hammocks, quite happy the way things are, very comfortable. Began their season in mid-July against KR Reykjavik in Champions League qualification, then the disappointments against Legia and Maribor, that draw in Salzburg last week is a good basis to go forward with.
Yeah, it's been an indifferent start to the season from Celtic, but that's 3 months now.
Is that to be expected, just with the new manager coming in?
You always have a period of time when you've got new players coming in, a new manager coming in, new systems, new ideas, new training methods.
You have that yourself, of course, at St Mirren.
Yeah, well, I mean, it just takes time to gel with new players. We're talking about building relationships on the pitch and off the pitch. But I think that period's probably now over. 3 months, Ronnie Dyle has been in the job, and I don't think it's an excuse anymore. I think what he needs now is results. This is certainly a very good result for him tonight.
Brilliantly done there by Izaguirre. Stokes is there in support. Izaguirre himself!
He really deserved that. He's been the man of the match tonight, Izaguirre. Absolutely fantastic. An outlet going forward, taking his man on. 1-2s, getting numerous balls in the box. Great bit of skill here. Commits the defender. And then he just drags a shot. Difficult angle to score from, really, on his left foot. But what a match he's had.
Just got the one goal for Celtic. It was against St Johnston. It's a few years ago now. Izaguirre, who, like Ambrose, played for his country at the World Cup finals. All three of Honduras' matches against France, Ecuador and Switzerland. Ambrose featured against Iran, Bosnia, Argentina and then France in the last 16. Here's Stokes, away from the slipping and sliding Patterson. Stokes ball in, palmed away by Alexander.
If Celtic's final ball had been just a wee touch better tonight when they got in the final third in those crossing positions, they could have scored a few more goals. And yeah, it's a good save from Neil Alexander, but he palms it out into the central area. That scramble it clear.
El Hassanoui there, was in the Moroccan Olympic squad in London 2012. He was born in the Netherlands. One of the new signings for Hearts, signed a three-year deal, having been at Sparta Rotterdam in the second tier of Dutch football. Here's a Dutchman here, former Groningen defender Virgil van Dijk.
Taking chances.
He's overcooked it. Wabben. Thread it through.
It's the sort of thing throughout the season that Celtic are going to get caught with. At times they almost play a 2-4-4, just leaving two defenders back the pitch, the amount that they attack. And if van Dijk is willing to take risks like that throughout the season, people will score goals from errors, not just from van Dijk, but from other Celtic players, because they just can't recover because of the overcommitting to attack. And that's all very well when you're 3-0 up, but in games I think they will get caught out one or two matches if this is the way that they're going to go.
6.5 plus stoppages to be played. Stjepovic. Tonev. The less said about that, the better. He's just celebrated his 39th birthday, Ronnie Dyla. He'd be fairly content with what he's seen. There have been the issues that he still needs to address at the back. They have reared their ugly heads now and again.
He'll be desperate for a clean sheet, absolutely desperate, because Celtic have been really struggling for clean sheets. There's been a lot of positives in the game, as I mentioned, as Zahiri, John Guidetti, Scott Brown getting another 90 minutes under his belt. He's been quietly efficient and effective. And they've looked a threat, Celtic. However, for all their good points, there have been moments of capitulation from them. And they're their own worst enemy at times, from overplaying, from overcommitting. But if that's the way that he wants to play and the way that they're going to play, then you know, that's the risk you've got to take. You will score goals, but you're going to concede some along the way.
Here's Ambrose. There was Keatings and O'Connell. The book's out. It is yellow.
It's a definite foul. He definitely pushes Keatings out of the way. I don't know if the yellow was for dissent.
Got himself in a fankle to do an O'Connell. Good touch by Holt. Not so much of him since he came on. Asanui blocked. Izagiri. That's a Celtic free kick.
It's a clumsy foul.
It's frustration, isn't it?
Well, it is. It's also a striker's challenge, really. It's a poor challenge. Again, Willie Collin quite quick with the yellows. I don't know if that's his first tackle, but a yellow card.
Scott Brown in the foreground there, just watching on that foul. He wasn't on the Celtic team charter back from Salzburg last week. He missed it. He was in having a drugs test with Alexander Tonev. Tonev made the flight, Brown didn't. To make his way back the day after, there was very strict rules at the airport in Salzburg. They weren't allowed to fly aircraft in and out after a certain time last week, so Scott Brown didn't make the flight.
I don't think Hearts should be too despondent about tonight's result. As we said, the league's probably their main focus this season. For the first 15-20 minutes, they looked as though they were going to cause Celtic one or two problems. They looked quite comfortable in their shape. But as the game wore on, Celtic's quality told, and they really couldn't cope with it. But they're certainly not the first team, and they won't be the last to come here and lose heavily to Celtic. They did have opportunities in the game to bring themselves back into the match, a couple of really, really good opportunities. And as Michael Stewart said at half-time, when you're here, you've got to take them. And unfortunately for Hearts, they didn't.
Without a doubt, it is convincing for Celtic, and they have deserved it. They probably, arguably, deserved the 3-0 lead that they have just now. But things could have been completely different had Osman Sow scored that penalty, had Jamie Walker just before half-time, and the shot being a couple of inches lower, it's one apiece and it's a different game. Yeah, Celtic are jittery.
Yeah, we could have thrown that on Celtic though as well, because if you look at the opportunities they've created, they've probably created, you know, if you look at John Guidetti's in the first half and a couple in the second half, they've probably created another six or seven glorious opportunities that they've not taken. They've dominated this second half and thoroughly deserved the victory in the end.
Tonev then, Johansson switches it right to left. Stjepovic, Commons, and Stokes waits for Izaguirre, shuffles inside. It'll be interesting to see if Ronny Dyla will use the Stokes-Izaguirre combo going forward. Tonev rifles it past.
Well, I think he will. I think he'd be mad not to. He's been so impressive tonight.
Scott Brown gets the sponsor's man of the match in the midst of all that all-action performance.
Yeah,
and he does look back to full fitness.
He does. He's a very fit person. I think he's in an effective match. I think he's done his job very well, very professionally. I've seen him play better. For me, the man of the match would have been Izaguirre. I think he's been a standout. But there's been a lot of good performances from Celtic players tonight, and that'll please their manager. And it was important for Ronny Dyla to get a result tonight, regardless of performance, and he's done that. And I think that should helpfully ease things for him. And I think, you know, if I was him, I would keep the same team. I would play the same team and try and let them build more partnerships like Izaguirre Stokes. Let them get to know each other better and know the formation better. It's the only way to build consistency.
It's Dyla's team now, pretty much. Albeit a good number of the players out there were signed under the previous regime, but he's got the team and the players on the pitch that he wants to have now. He'll be pretty content with what he's seen in an attacking sense tonight.
They've not really been tested defensively, certainly not in open play this second half, and most of the opportunities the Hearts did create were Celtic's own.
We're into 2 minutes of stoppage time at the end, and it can't end quickly enough for the men in maroon. Well beaten in the end up. As a reminder, the draw for the quarter-finals of the League Cup will be made after they're done at Tannadice. And of course, Hamilton, Motherwell, last we heard, both ties goalless. They're half an hour behind this one. BBC Radio Scotland 810 Medium Wave Sports Sound will have the draw. Here's Commons. He's offside.
Great play again, Izaguirre cutting inside three. Lovely pass from outside of his boot, and Commons just straight offside. I think the message, if you're Robbie Nielsen, for the Hearts players, is just forget all about it and look forward to Livingston on Saturday. That's obviously now the main focus. You want to keep their unbeaten league record going.
Stevie Crawford alongside Robbie Nielsen on the Hearts bench there. The Raith Rovers striker, because Raith Rovers were the most famous victories in this competition in 1994 against Celtic. A good run, which has ended up in a corner, won by Holt off Ambrose. It'll be just about the final action, final act of this third round tie. And it's been a bridge too far for a Hearts team that are 3 points clear at the top of the championship. Craig Gordon came off his line there, but it's a Celtic ball, Celtic free kick. Perhaps it had gone behind for the goal kick. I think it has, yeah.
Yeah, I think it curled out of play.
Final thoughts, Stephen?
Well, Celtic deserving the victory. It could have been very different had the Osman So scored his penalty. However, I do think that Celtic would still have turned out to be victorious in the match. From a Hearts point of view, you know, there's not too much to take from the game. They will not play a team like this again unless they get Celtic again this season. So they don't need to worry about that. And for Celtic, positives.
12 months on from an embarrassing exit at this stage of this competition to Greenock Morton, Ronny Dyla guides Celtic past Hearts with an easy scoreline in the end up John Guidetti got the opener in the first half. Osman Sow missing a penalty after Jamie Walker had hit the bar. Chris Commons with a penalty a minute after Hearts missed there, so Chris Commons, and then an own goal from Adam Eckersley, the Hearts left back. The Englishman putting it past his own keeper mean that Celtic will go through to tonight's Scottish League Cup quarter-final draw, where they join Aberdeen, Partick Thistle, Rangers, St Johnston and Hibernian, with another two to come from the Dundee United-Dundee match, Hamilton Motherwell as well. It's a cruise in the end up for the Premiership champions. Look back to their best in an attacking sense tonight. It finishes at Celtic Park. Celtic 3, Heart of Midlothian 0.
So Celtic are team number six through to the quarterfinals of the League Cup. John Guidetti getting his first goal for the club. Here he is with Al Lamont.
Yeah, John's with me. Chris Commons too. John, we'll come to you first though. How pleasing to get your first goal in a cup win here?
Yeah, it's fantastic. We need the win, and I think we played really well today. And of course, it's always nice to get your first goal.
Do you find that you're getting used to playing with Celtic now? You obviously in the starting 11, and obviously I guess getting the first goal gives you great confidence.
Yeah, of course, but I have confidence because I know when I play with great players like I'm playing, then chances are going to come. So, you know, so easy to win. You're playing with the boys. They've been great to me ever since I came, taking care of me. So when you come into such a great group and the way they treated me, it's quite easy to adapt.
Chris, your goal, I suppose, settled nerves to an extent. It came just after Hearts had missed the chance to pull themselves level, so very crucial that you didn't make the same mistake as Osman Sow.
Yeah, you know, I was confident, scored one only a couple of days ago, so, you know, I've got to keep mixing it up and changing, making sure, you know, I pick my spot out and strike it well, and that's what I did, and yeah, it just shows you, obviously, if they scored it, puts a whole different complex on the game, but obviously 2-0, it kind of made it a lot more easy, a lot more relaxed, and, you know, I think as soon as we did get the two goals, we started playing a little bit more freely.
You guys have got so many options in the attacking positions. John coming in today and scoring his goal. What has this guy brought to the team since he's come up here?
Just the freshness, you know, his wonderful movement, good touch, knows where the back of the net is, at least after 10 minutes anyway. But no, you can see he's, you know, highly talented, and, you know, I think he will get better. You know, I think we'll get a good relationship going, and, you know, obviously he'll get more goals and, you know, start, you know, trying to win some cups.
John, do you feel there is much more to come from you as you get more used to the guys you're playing with, and I suppose as you get up to 100% match fitness as well?
Of course, you know, we improve all the time. Me and Chris, we're starting to find each other, but we can find each other even more, you know, as I know how he moves and how I move, and it's normal. It takes some time to get to know each other. It doesn't happen over a day, but it felt better today, felt better second half last game, so we're gradually getting better and better, and hopefully we can win trophies for this football club.
And there's a lot of competition it seems that the manager wants to play essentially one main striker. There's Stefan, of course, there's Anthony Stokes who played wide today, Lee Griffiths even. So you have to be at the top of your game if you want to be in the manager's first 11, don't you?
Listen, at the end of the day, it's about winning trophies for this club, and we have so many games. We're going to need the full squad, and every time you go out, of course, you want to make yourself proud, and you want to make the team proud. So it's not for yourself you do it, it's for the team you do it. So we're going to need the whole squad. We're going to need every single one to play at the best, because it's not enough one guy does his job. We have to have 11.
Guys, congratulations tonight. Thanks for your time. Cheers.
Well, we'll talk more about this game in a moment, but let's catch up meantime on what's happening in the other two ties, which are very much ongoing in this League Cup competition. The Dundee Derby at Tannadice, still goalless, Jim Spence.
It's 0-0 at the moment, midway through, and Dundee United almost conceding an own goal here, knocked by for a corner kick by Sean Dillon, I think that was, as Dundee pressed there. Remember, Dundee down to 10 men, robbed in a 27 minutes, Martin Boyle got a straight red for denying Armstrong an obvious goal scoring opportunity, and 10 minutes before that, Greg Stewart's penalty had been saved by United keeper Chersniak after John Rankin had couped Paul McGowan in the box, but it's all United until that wee break by Dundee there, and they've rattled the woodwork twice in succession, once through Nadio Chifchi, then through Gary Mackay-Stephen, which brought a good save from Leathern, touching it on the post, and Dundee have just chipped one over the bar. So this one is raging from end to end. United have been dominant. Dundee 10-man Dundee trying to fight their way back into the game. 23 minutes gone of the second half. It's United 0, Dundee 0.
So, Spencey, a bit of a letdown at Tannadice, still goalless there. Richard Wilson can't do much better at New Douglas Park. Hamilton Motherwell.
I'm afraid not, Rob. Bit of a letdown here too, although Hamilton were reduced to 10 men just 5 minutes ago when Stephen Hendry, the fullback, was sent off for his second yellow card, a second foul of the night on Lionel Ainsworth, the Motherwell winger. There's been lots of effort, lots of industry, lots of sweat spilled for the cause, but not enough accomplishment from either side in this game, so clear-cut chances have been at a real premium. Second half hasn't delivered much. Eamon Brophy had a shot into the side netting. Motherwell had a loud claim for a penalty when Ainsworth saw a shot blocked inside the penalty area, but the referee, Craig Charlson, wasn't having any of it. It's 0-0 here, although it's Motherwell who have the advantage at the moment. They've got 11 men, Hamilton down to 10.
And coverage of those two League Cup ties is continuing at the moment on BBC Radio Scotland 810 Medium Wave. Our live television match tonight ended Celtic 3, Hearts 0. Let's hear from Charlie Mulgrew and from Michael Stewart as well. Comfortable in the end, Charlie, for Celtic, but one or two scary moments.
Yeah, the penalty's a big moment in the game. Hearts go on and miss it, and then we get one at the other end and managed to score it, and then I think the game was just all us after that, so it was a good performance and definitely encouraging signs there.
I think Hearts will feel, Michael, maybe that they've made too much of a contribution themselves to Celtic's win.
Yeah, I don't think there's any doubt about it. I think that Robbie Nielsen will be looking at that game and thinking, I can't remember Hearts putting a tackle in, especially in the second half there. And all the defining moments of the game, Hearts had a part to play in it, in their own downfall. You look at the first goal, Danny Wilson needs to do better with the cross. You look at the second goal, and it's poor defending there again. There's no need for Ozturk to put a challenge in on, I think it was Guidetti. He doesn't need to challenge him. He's not going to get a strike off. And then the third goal, obviously the own goal. So it's pretty poor from a Hearts perspective there.
We've heard from Messrs Guidetti and Commons. Let's hear from the manager now. Ronnie Dial with Al.
Ronnie, good comprehensive victory in the end. How pleased were you with the overall performance?
I'm very pleased. I think we are going in the right direction all the time now. And what I'm most pleased of is two things. One, we work as a team. 11 players who want to win the ball and are working together, so we have the ball a lot. And two, we're starting to create something on the sides, and especially with the Stokesy and Emilio today was good, and that's something to build better and better.
Yeah, throughout that match, that down that left wing, Anthony and Emilio made so many chances for the team, didn't they? I imagine something you would like to cultivate and see more of in future matches.
Yeah, my philosophy in football, we need to be very dangerous on the sides and also in the centre. In the centre, Celtic has been very good now in several years. But I think to create 2v1, 3v2 on the sides, we can do better. And today we did well that on the left side. And we kept a clean sheet as well, that was good.
John Guidetti obviously got his first goal for the club. That would, I know he's not a man who lacks confidence anyway, but strikers thrive on that, don't they? And you would hope that would be the first of many for the club.
Yeah, he's a very good boy. He works hard every day. And he's, of course, a lot to improve the physical way, because he's been out for a long time and haven't played matches. So that's why he can stay 90 minutes still. But he had a huge impact on the game today, and that was good.
And you mentioned the clean sheet, obviously that must be hugely encouraging. There were a couple of chances though for Hearts. I'm sure that's something that, as pleased as you are about the positive aspects, that a couple of chances that you gave away and things could have been quite different, couldn't they?
Yeah, you can say so, but if you had scored on other chances, there would have been no match either. So we gave away chances, and that's easier to do something with. If we had been played out, I would have more worries. But I know this is just an individual things, and that is something we can do much better on Saturday.
Is giving away a chance here or there something that you're willing to almost sacrifice because you want to be as positive as possible and score as many goals as possible?
I would rather win 5-4 than 1-0, but the best we have been 5-0.
And so, clearly into the quarterfinals now, you were asked a couple of days ago about the prospect maybe of meeting Rangers. Would you like that to happen in the quarterfinals, or would you rather ideally save that to the final if possible?
We are looking forward to the next game anyway, what we're going to meet. And we know we are comfortable that we are a very good team, and whoever we meet, they're going to have a big challenge.
And again, the game's coming thick and fast. You've got St Mirren obviously in the league, and then another European tie here against Dinamo Zagreb. Are you, ideally, would you like to stick with that, the 11 who were so impressive tonight?
I think we have players coming on doing well as well, so, and we have people on the bench can do well. But I think it's important to keep more consistency in the team, because if you change too much, as I've done twice, then we haven't played well, and I can understand why.
Good man. Thanks for your time tonight, Ronnie. Cheers.
Ronnie Dyla, the Victoria Celtic manager, talking there about lots of things, but included in that was the threat from Celtic down the left side, Charlie, the link-up between Stokes and Izaguirre. Does that maybe mean that he should be thinking about playing a more settled team more often? I mean, there were six changes between Salzburg and Sunday, and that doesn't give a chance to develop understandings.
Always helps when there's a settled team, settled back four, which there has been. And I think the manager's still finding out who his best team is. And I think the combination in the wide area, on the left side especially, tonight, second half, was brilliant. I mean, Stokesy came short and got it, and Emilio made some great runs. So I think that's a big thing the manager wants, is combination in the wide areas. And I think we got that well, definitely, and got that right tonight, definitely, on the left-hand side.
Let's look back on some of the key moments of the match. Well, we'll do that in a sec, because Robbie Neilson, the Hearts head coach, has appeared in the tunnel. Let's hear from him.
Robbie, obviously this was a big task coming to Celtic Park to face the Premiership champions, but do you feel that Hearts gave it all they could?
Yeah, I thought the game hinged on the penalty. You know, if we go 1-0 down and we still stay strong. You know, we had a lot of good passing, we got a lot of good movement, the boys were confident in the ball, we hit the crossbar, came out of the second half and we get the penalty, you know, and we miss the penalty and the game totally changes from there. You know, they got the part, they get a penalty, goes 2-0, and it's very difficult if crowds start getting behind them and the atmosphere changes and they start getting confidence and popping the ball about, and then we lose another poor one to go 3, and it's difficult. But even then, I thought we still passed it. You know, it's a difficult place to come. You know, no matter what team you are, you know, it's hard place to come, and they start popping it about and dropping into little holes. But no, I'm pleased with the performance overall, disappointed with the score, but at the end of the day, the league's the main thing for us, and we gear up now for Sunday.
Sure. I mean, I guess every goal you could say is avoidable, but in terms of the three you did concede, is it disheartening that you were kind of your own worst enemies probably with all three of them?
Yeah, you know, we've defended really well this season. You know, our back four and goalkeeper and centre midfielders have been fantastic, and you know, we knew we were going to have to be fantastic again coming tonight to get a clean sheet. And yeah, disappointing to lose a goal, but like you said, you know, every goal is avoidable. Every goal you can track back, and there's some mistake somewhere. And we had three bad ones tonight, but they were taking the chance. I'd rather do it in the League Cup of bad defending than I would in the league.
Is there a number of things you can take from this game in terms of the positive aspects?
Yeah, definitely. You know, I thought, yeah, there's not many teams who come to Parkhead and pass the ball about like we did, you know, passed it at the back, you know, took things short, you know, to try and move them about and try and control the game a little bit. And, you know, it was great, I was pleased with them. Disappointed with the score, but pleased with the performance. You know, they passed it, they moved, they got into good opportunities and goal-scoring opportunities, and just failed to take some of them.
OK, commiserations tonight. Thanks, Robbie. Okay.
Cheers.
Swedes have a history at Celtic, Charlie. I'm not suggesting for a moment John Guidetti is the new Henrik Larsson, but there was lots of encouragement from his performance tonight, not least the goal.
Definitely, aye. As I said, it was a great finish. He worked the line well tonight. He worked hard up there and took his chance well. Here we see it here. It's a great cross by Emilio, right in that in between the defenders and the goalkeeper, and then it drops to.
You see the movement there from Guidetti. You know, he can realise that he's not going to get on the end of that cross, so he just holds his position. That's good instinct from a striker. You know, sometimes if you can't get in there, you just hold your position, and it's poor defending. But he's in that area and he's able to get onto.
Still got
it.
A bit to do there. I mean, there's players in front of him, and he's put it in.
Yep,
the only place he could really put it, to be honest. Yeah. So it's a good finish.
So that was Celtic 1 up. We're about to see Hearts missing a big chance to get the game all squared up at half-time. What we should be stressing, though, before we see this, is that Celtic had half a dozen chances before Guidetti scored. As Ronnie Dyla said in his interview, it could all have been put to bed early on.
It could have, yeah. I mean, I think, you know, the first 20, 25 minutes, Robbie would have been happy with it. I think that they were, you know, they were solid. They weren't giving too much away, but as the game wore on, Celtic started to get into it. They were opening Hearts up and they were creating quite a lot of chances. And then just before half-time, obviously, you know, Celtic almost the downfall of themselves here with a, you know, a really poor back pass to towards Craig Gordon, and Jimmy Walker gets onto it. You know, he's quick, he reacts well. You know, he's the first one to react. The whole Celtic defence are static, just a bit too much time to think about it, and he's really got to be scoring there. And I said it at half time, when you come to Celtic Park and you get chances like that, you've got to put them in the back of the net, because there's few and far between. Lo and behold, actually, it comes into the second half and they got another fantastic opportunity with a penalty. But you can't go and give away those chances. You've got to get them in the back of the net.
I don't think you were too convinced, Charlie, that this should have been a penalty, should you, for Hearts early second half, although you would say that.
No, I didn't think it was a penalty. I mean, when you see it again here, it's good play with Hearts and a good run, but I think there is a bit of contact. But I think he's leaning in, trying to find Virg to lean on. Once he's leaning in there, looking for Virg's weight to take him, because it's not there, he goes over. I don't think it's a penalty. I think there's a bit of contact, but not enough to be given.
I think that, you know, the difficulty is there that you know, the Ryder Cup's coming on at Glen Eagles, and that's getting the driver out and just having a wild swipe at it there.
What is he thinking?
He's obviously just trying. I mean, it's almost like a leisurely, you know, strike as well. He's just trying to hit it high into the back of the net.
What I said, what is he thinking? What is Ozturk thinking here?
Well, I mean, again, you know, there's absolutely no need to even put any physical challenge onto him there. The ball's running away from him. He's not going to get onto it. And he just, you know, as a manager, you'd be looking at that thinking to yourself, self-inflicted. Fantastic finish from Chris Commons showing Osmond Sow how to, you know, put the ball in the back of the net from a penalty.
I mean, what a contrast in penalty taking from one end to the other in the space of a few minutes.
Aye, the first one's blazed over the bar. I think he's been too casual in the way he's approached the ball, but you see how he put a penalty away there by Chris, and he smashes it in the corner. That's a great pen.
All you need to do is hit the target. And you saw my crap one 5 years ago. You
know, wasn't that good?
But if you hit the target, you're going to make the goalkeeper work. Yeah. You know, and you know, you've got to make your mind up when you're going to take a penalty. You make your mind up early where you're going to put it, and you don't change your mind. There, as Charlie was saying, he looked, you know, a bit too lackadaisical in his approach to the ball, and you know, obviously try to hit it high, but it was too lackadaisical for me.
Hearts wanted to make Celtic work for this win tonight, and they'll be heading back to Edinburgh, Charlie, thinking that they've played too big a part themselves, haven't they? And here's an own goal just to round things off from Adam Eckersley.
Yeah, it's a great ball for Stokes. I mean, he smashed it across the face there, and he's tried to chest it back, and it's maybe just put your foot through it or head it out for a corner there, but he'll know that himself. I mean, he's tried to put it back to the keeper there when you should just deal with it, really.
It's poor all round, though. I mean, you look at that, that's a throw-in. And the ball's thrown in, and then, I think, was it Stokesy?
Stokesy.
It was a fantastic ball right across the, you know, in between the goalkeeper and the defenders there. But from a throw-in, you've got to set up. You can't allow, you know, a simple throw-in and then have a free cross at it, and then Eckersley at the back post. As Charlie says, he'll know himself. He doesn't need anybody else to tell him that, you know, that was a poor goal to give away.
This season for Hearts is not really about winning tonight. It would have been a great bonus if they had done it. It's all about getting promotion, getting back into the big league again. But they had a chance tonight, didn't they?
Yeah, I think they did. You know, coming to Celtic Park tonight, Celtic have not had a great run of things so far. They've not built up that momentum under Ronnie Dyla. And I think if they'd managed to keep it quiet and keep, you know, Celtic on the back foot, not giving anything away for, you know, at least 30 minutes, getting towards half-time, you're going at 0-0 at half-time, all of a sudden the crowd start getting a wee bit anxious, the players are getting a little bit unsure whether they're going to get, you know, that goal. But to lose a goal so early on, 20-25 minutes, it just changes the whole sort of dynamics of the game.
What pleased you most, Charlie, about tonight from a Celtic viewpoint?
I think the second half, after we scored the penalty, the way we pushed forward and looked for more, and we seemed to gain confidence as the game went on. And Stokesy on the left-hand side with Emilio was very encouraging, the way they played together and the way they combined. And I think that real positive was going forward.
Before we go, let's just catch up on those other two League Cup ties, which are still ongoing, still very much in the balance. Let's head for Tannadice, the Dundee Derby, and Spencer.
10-man Dundee defending for their lives, although they are in the attack at the moment. United have been coming at them in waves, Rob, but they cannot find a path to goal. 9 minutes to go, United 0, Dundee 0. This could be heading for extra time.
Yep, could be the late shift for Jim Spence tonight, and the same goes for Richard as well at New Douglas Park. How's it going, Richard?
Still 0-0, Rob. Hamilton reduced to 10 men. Motherwell have been top ever since then. Sutton's shot wide. Vigors had a shot saved. Motherwell on top, but it's still 0-0.
OK, so those matches still very much up for grabs in terms of the last two places in the quarterfinals of this League Cup competition. Coverage, of course, is continuing meantime on BBC Radio Scotland. 810 medium wave. But let's recap now on the story so far in the quarterfinals of the League Cup in terms of results in the third round. These, the results so far, and of course, the matches still to be settled. Aberdeen 4-0 winners last night against Livingston. That included an Adam Rooney hat-trick. Victory for Rangers at Falkirk by 3-1. One goal settled it at Rugby Park between St Johnstone and Kilmarnock. Brian Graham, on loan from Dundee United, striking again. In extra time, Partick Thistle beat St Mirren by 1-0. That was Nathan Eccleston's first for the club. And Hibs winners in Dingwall against Ross County, Malunga with both their goals. Tonight, those two matches still to be settled. The Dundee derby at Tannadice still goalless, and it is 0-0 as well between Hamilton and Motherwell at New Douglas Park. So coverage of those ties still ongoing on BBC Radio Scotland. You can join Richard and the crew for the climax of that, and also the draw to come at Tannadice after. Thanks a lot to Charlie Mulgrew and to Michael Stewart as well. 3-0 Celtic tonight, they're through to the quarterfinals.